Hey dudes, welcome to Splat from the Past, the only 80s themed horror and sci-fi show where things could get totally radical. Now today, I have a very special guest. But first, let's take a trip down memory lane, shall we? Yes, the whole world is celebrating, and I am your host, Tommy Throwback Kovac, and today, oh my god, I am just completely flabbergasted. I interviewed one of my earliest crushes when I was a kid, Tiffany Helm. You may remember her. She was a star of The Zoo Gang, and she played Violet in Friday the 13th Part 5, and she was in Reform School Girls, and OC and Stigs, and she just had a huge repertoire of great movie roles back in the 80s, and I got to interview her. She far exceeded my expectations. She was an absolute genuine sweetheart, and she has a great sense of humor. She's very funny, and she's also the daughter of Brooke Bundy, who played Kristen's mother in Nightmare on Elm Street 3 and 4. And we had a great talk, and here it is. This is my talk today with the great and beautifully talented Tiffany Helm.
So, Tiffany, how are you doing today?
I'm doing almost excellent. Actually, I am excellent.
Well, I don't blame you. I mean, you had a really good meeting with the director yesterday.
Yep, I had a great meeting, and I'm going to be doing some film work, too. So, I'm pretty happy about that.
Oh, you're happy. I'm pretty happy about that, because I've missed you from the screen for many, many years.
Right on. Well, it'll be nice to have some current film.
Yes.
For myself. So I'm excited about it.
Yes, I can't wait. It's going to be awesome. I was looking at your credits, and one of the first things you did an episode of Likely Stories.
Yes.
Which episode were you on? Because there's no record of it.
They're actually, oh my goodness, I was actually going to look this up for you. It's not on my, I think it's on my IMDb, isn't it? Did you look it up?
It's on IMDb, but it doesn't specify which episode that you're in and all the other ones that are listed.
Okay, well it was, I think I was trying to figure out who it was. It was, again, one of my first things. But yeah, so I'm clicking on that, and I don't know who was the, I all remember I was, it was like kind of a space age, we were dressed up in space age stuff, and I was a sister, I had a brother on it. I'm trying to think who the full cast and crew, let's see. Directed by David Webster, I said. I think it's The Trip to Tomorrow. I'm looking at it right now. Series directed by. I think it was David Webster. Trip to Tomorrow. Yes, I'm going to go with that one.
Okay. Yeah, I remember watching episodes of the show on tape when I was a kid. I thought I was the only person in the world who actually knew that show, because it's so obscure because it was on Cinemax back before Cinemax was even known, you know?
Right. Yeah, and I mean, when I saw that you were going to ask about that, I was like, oh, I got to do some research on it, because that was a long time ago.
Yeah, you probably don't even see your residuals from it, huh?
No, and I think it was a buyout, as I recall. I don't think I ever got residuals on that. I'm pretty sure it was buyout.
No, that's crazy. And, you played a fan in the Rick Springfield movie Hard to Hold. Were you a Rick Springfield fan?
No, are you kidding? I was like the alternative music kid. But it was, again, it was really fun. I mean, it's all I did was basically lead around the pack of screaming girls, right?
Yeah.
But because I'm recognizable and you see me regularly, I was actually considered featured. I wasn't, I was a glorified extra, right? But because I was the leader of the pack, I was considered an actress in it. But yeah, it was a lot of fun to work on that.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. I like Rick Springfield's music, and he's a good looking guy too. He was on General Hospital.
Yep.
Yeah.
He was.
And then you did the Zoo Gang, and this is where I fell in love with you when I was a little boy.
Aww.
Yeah, I used to see this movie like every other day on HBO, and every time it was on, I was so excited. I was like, yay, my girlfriend is on.
The ever-changing sized girlfriend. Did you notice that? How my look changed pretty dramatically from scene to scene?
It's been a while since I saw it, and I have to go back and see.
I probably put off 30 pounds during that shoot. It was a very stressful time for me, and wardrobe was not at all happy with me, because it's like I started off quite slim, and I just was packing on the pounds. None of my clothes would fit me or anything. They had to get new clothes for me. They were not happy with me.
Oh. I never noticed.
It's kind of funny if you watch it. I mean, you can see, well, I mean, I really noticed it. I don't know how it looks to somebody else, but you can see my face just a little chubby and so, it's kind of funny. I don't think the directors thought it was very funny, but they were pretty irritated, but, you know.
Oh. I would have let you keep the $5 and I would have danced with you.
Aw. Nice. And I did, the OC and Stings was before Zoo Gang. I had done that right before. And then went to Zoo Gang.
Yeah. I know Mark Price a little bit. He and I are both stand-up comedians and we have mutual friends.
Well, nice.
Yeah. Is there any good stories about Mark?
I can't remember specific stories about Mark. I mean, he was always entertaining, you know. We would all go out together as much as we could in Prescott, Arizona. There wasn't a whole lot to do there. Not for really, like, young city people, which we were. You know, there was a couple cowboy bars and stuff like that, but that really wasn't our cup of tea.
Yeah, especially...
Mark was super cool.
Especially since a lot of you were probably like teenagers at that time, right?
Well, I was a little more than a teenager, but okay. In my 20s.
Back then, wasn't some bars like 18?
Yeah, I think in Arizona, Arizona was 19, I believe.
Oh.
So, yeah, I think, if I'm not mistaken, that seems to ring a bell. I know like New York State is 18, but I think Arizona is 19. And they have those drive-through liquor stores, too, which is very similar to me.
Yeah, I lived in Arizona for a brief period about 10 years ago. I had to come back to California, though. I was just so hot over there.
Yeah, it gets a little toasty. Well, it was about a 100-degree difference when I went from shooting in Phoenix on the Altman film and then going to Prescott. So, that's 100-degree difference.
Yeah. What was it like working with the legendary Ty Harden?
I don't remember very much. I remember he would forget his lines sometimes, that I remember. And the only incident I really remember, and he's the one who played my dad, right?
Yeah.
The only incident that I really remember, and I hope this is okay to say, but it's the scene where... Like, I don't know, we introduce him, Jason Gendrick comes in, and they're introduced or whatever, and there's a pizza, and he says, the end of the scene is like, hey, come and help me eat this pizza.
Oh, yeah, I remember that scene.
Yeah, well, accidentally said something besides pizza that sounds a little bit like pizza, mm-hmm. and so you can guess what he said, and it got quite a laugh from the entire cast and crew, and I don't even think he realized what he had said until everybody was like busting out laughing. And I was just kind of stunned going, Dad! fun on the set.
Yeah, oh my God. I'll tell my dad that story and he'll laugh because he grew up watching him on Bronco, you know?
Okay.
And so he'll love that.
I remember that one. I don't know if Ty wants to remember that one, but I do, and I bet a lot of the cast and crew remember it too.
So you did OC and Sticks first, right?
Yeah.
What was that like?
Oh, it was great. I mean, that's really, you know, what sucked me into the industry, working with Robert Altman. Truly an amazing director, and he just, you know, his attitude basically is like, I hired you, you were right for the role, so here's basically what's going on in the scene, go. Like, and he would give you pretty much free rein in there, to a degree. I mean, there was a scene with King Sunny Ade playing on stage, and I took the freedom a little bit too far and acted like a screaming Beatles fan or something, which I thought would be very funny, listening to King Sunny Ade. And I got up on stage with him and was like, oh my God! And Mr. Altman didn't think that was good, and his cameras are rolling, he can't just stop them. But I could see him at the corner, like, waving his arms, like, get her off of the stage! She's not supposed to be doing that! So, you know, but other than that, all good.
My God. Yeah, I saw the movie once about 12 years ago or something. And it kind of went over my head. I kept saying to myself as I sat there watching, is this a teen movie or is it a Robert Altman movie trying to be a teen movie?
It's a little hard to follow.
Yeah.
I think, and it got quite a bit of acclaim, I think, in Europe, but, you know, it didn't do well in North America. It's very obscure. It's very difficult to follow. And it happens with Altman films, too. Sometimes they lose their linearity because of the freedom that he gives to the actors. So I think probably a lot got lost on editing too. Because the script was funny as heck.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember that?
Maybe it needs to be remade.
Yeah.
It's a great cast.
But it was a great cast. Like, it was amazing working with all those A-list actors for sure.
Yeah, John Cryer, Dennis Hopper, Ray Walston, Jane Curtin, Tina Louise, who played Ginger on Gilligan's Island.
Mm-hmm.
Any stories about her?
Tina?
Yeah.
I just remember her cruising around the hotel grounds in a little golf cart while the rest of us were walking in that hot-ass sun. And she had, like, a little golf cart and a parasol.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what's up with that, man?
Yeah. And then you did Friday the 13th, Part 5, and I was about 8 years old when I saw this. I started watching the series when I was like 8, and this has always been one of my favorite of the sequels. I just think it's really cool, Part 5.
And why do you like it so much?
Well, it's got a little bit of humor in it, not so much as Part 6 ended up having, but it's got humor in it, and it's really fast-paced, I think.
Okay.
Were you a fan of the series?
Not really. I mean, I had gone out, you know, I would see all of the first ones of the slasher movies, but I didn't really go into second or third because I really felt like I've seen it, I've done it.
Yeah.
So, no, I mean, I like horror, but I'm more into, like, psychological horror, so much graphic violence.
Oh. Yeah, my dad's into, like, supernatural stuff. He hates slasher movies, but I love them.
That's great. You guys are a good team, then.
Yeah. You,
The other thing you really reminded me of in this movie was Daryl Hannah and Blade Runner.
Oh, wow. Thank you. That's quite a compliment. I loved her look in that.
Yeah.
And I didn't base Violet's look on that at all, but it's, I really, she was super cool, and she was doing it pretty early on, too, before it was super cool, right?
Right.
And she looked great.
And you dance in the movie. Are you a classically trained dancer?
I had done dance when I was quite young, but that had nothing to do with being classically trained. That was just what we were doing in the clubs. I would go to alternative clubs and such. And actually, the first time I saw somebody do that particular dance, I was like instantly in love. It was this boy who did that type of dancing to the old, I don't know if you remember the song Send Me an Angel, My Real Life.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was his song, and he would get up and do this, whatever synth pop robot thing, dance to it, and I was just like mesmerized, and I decided I needed to be able to dance like that too when I was practicing, and I got my own songs, and he and I became friends as a result. So, but that was the, not everybody in the clubs was doing that dance, but there was a handful of us who would do that, and it would attract quite a bit of attention, so I was able to bring it to the film.
Nice. And your death scene was pretty good. Jason gave you another belly button.
Yeah.
If I could be killed by Jason in any of those movies, I'd like to be tickled to death.
Ah, okay. I don't think he does much tickling.
Well, that's why it would be a very original kill, because I don't like pain.
Yeah. That'd be a great parody.
Oh, yeah. I didn't even think of that. And I'm a comedy writer. I should have thought of that just now. But you gave me an idea.
Yeah, you could have one kill being tickled to death, another kill like having to watch a Taylor Swift concert or something. You could do another one like watching reruns of Facts of Life or...
Oh, God, I love Facts of Life. That would be Wings. I need Wings.
Not to offend Taylor Swift fans or Facts of Life fans, but still, it's a funny premise.
Yeah. Now, Taylor Swift, yes, but I love Facts of Life. Maybe Wings, because I hated Wings.
Okay, yeah. Actually, I like that show, as I recall. But I'm sure we can find something that everybody agrees to not like.
Yeah. Hold on one second.
The story that goes with it was that there was a scene in the shower scene. I had my best friend out there doing extra work as well. And there was a shot that the director wanted that I felt very uncomfortable with him doing. Uh-huh. It was okay doing the shower scene, but he was saying, like, you guys are going to saunter by and the camera's going to pan down you, and this is when we're naked. And I'm, you know, next to Darcy DeMoss and Wendy O. Williams, mm-hmm. who are both, like, hard bodies, and I was a little kind of pudgy and quite white at the time. And I was like, I really am uncomfortable doing that. I'm not refusing to be in the scene, but I don't want to be in that shot. Mm-hmm. And I called my union, and they said that they would back me up, that they that an actor can back out of the nudity clause any time except for after the film has been shot, which makes sense. So I was trying to work with the director and say, I am just not comfortable being in this shot, but my girlfriend, my best friend who was doing the extra work out there, was totally happy showing off all her stuff. She would get naked every chance she got. She looked great, amazing body, and she was happy to do it. I'm like, my friend will do it, though. She'll be my replacement. And it just made the director angry, and I was told that was my last day.
Wow, that sucks. That really sucks.
So, for everybody out there who doesn't want to necessarily take off their clothes, you don't have to.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
There's the lesson there.
I agree. You're so lucky, though, because you got to be in two New World movies, and you got to play two very different characters, a good girl and a very bad girl.
Yeah, and I tell you what, I actually, after the whole Reform School Girls debacle, I actually went in to read for another New World film, and I remember what it was, but the head of New World was there, and I had never met him in person.
Mm-hmm.
And I was ready to do my reading, and I was introduced to everybody. When I heard his name, I was like, oh. And he just glared at me.
Oh.
He knew me, and to him, I was trouble, right? And I was like, oh, okay. So I kind of muddled through my reading and scurried out of that casting session. New World was not happy with me.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, it was too bad. But, you know, so it goes.
I got to say that I always loved your introduction in the movie. You're like eating with your middle fingernail.
Yeah.
I love that. Great.
Yeah, it was fun. Like, there was some fun stuff that happened in it. You know, no, I don't regret any of my jobs that I've done. It's fabulous work. If you can get the work, it's great work.
Absolutely. And then you did an episode of Freddy's Nightmares where you played a waitress.
Yep.
What was that like?
That was really fun. That was, and you know, my mom was, that was earlier that she did the Nightmare on Elm Street. So we all had a tie to Freddy. But, you know, it was a lot of fun. It was an easy shoot, and I got to be a very pregnant waitress.
Mm-hmm.
That gives birth to Freddy's baby. But yeah, it was a fun shoot, definitely. It was just fun.
What was that shot at?
That was some studio in probably in Burbank or Hollywood.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if it was shot in Canada or anything, because I know a lot of those horror anthology shows were shot in Canada.
Oh no. No, the only time I worked in Canada as an actress. Well, I will be soon, but when I did the Jump Street.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Sarah, did you ever audition for anything that became iconic?
Oh, yeah. A few of them. One of my saddest loss, still to this day, I would say, was Heather's.
Oh.
Yeah, I was down to the wire for Heather's, and they went all blonde, right?
Yeah.
And I was brunette at the time. Like, there was a few brunettes, and I don't know if ultimately that's why I didn't get it, but it's down to the wire on that. married just a few years later. So I was out at a bar, drowning my sorrows. But yeah, so I've been out, I mean, for quite a few, I guess you'd say, I don't even know if they'd be considered iconic or not. But yeah, Heather's, there was Nancy I went in for.
Oh, nice. You would have been perfect for that.
Yeah, well, I mean, she did a great job on it. I don't even remember what, I think, I had a very different look at the time, you know. But there were not many punk rock looking people in the industry at that time, so they did set me into that. I've been on a lot of different stuff. It's hard to keep track of it all, but yes. But I would say Heather's is the big one that I was like, the one that got away.
Yeah, that's sad. I think that would have been your like big breakout role.
Yeah, for sure. But that's okay. On we go.
Yeah. So, at what point did you decide you were going to give up acting and go into photography?
Well, I moved to Seattle. See, I was there for 18 years. I've been here for 24 years ago or so. Seattle just doesn't have much of a acting industry.
Yeah.
It's pretty provincial there, and the film commission, like, I don't know where they're at these days, but back then, like, they just weren't seeing the amount of money that comes in when crews shoot in your city.
Mm-hmm.
And they're finding, too, that, you know, British Columbia looked just like Seattle, and you could get the great exchange rate. So American crews would shoot in Vancouver and around in D.C., and it looked just like Seattle. So I worked a little bit in Seattle. I did a video game.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a show called Medicine Ball.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say there's something else I did there, but there just really wasn't that much work. So I had always been interested in photography and started really pursuing it and established a pretty decent portrait business there.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, as long as you're happy, you know, you can make a decent living. I mean, that's all that really matters.
Yeah, and get that creative Jones out, right?
Right. I mean, you know, I miss you from the screen, but, you know, fortunately, everything worked well with that meeting you had, so I'm pretty excited now.
Yeah, and it's just, I mean, it's a small part, but it's a very interesting role, so we'll see how it goes, and I will definitely keep people posted on my fan page and such. What happens to it? I mean, it may never see the light of the theater. The director is saying it's going to be in Sundance. His last film was in Sundance.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm completely happy. You never know where those little indie films go, right? I mean,
right.
And I just, the director, I think he's a very promising young director. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes. That's all I can say about it.
Yeah, absolutely. It is, you know, movie market, just so many things go so unseen, you know.
Yeah. Well, I think this will be seen. It's just I don't know that it'll ever be like a box office. But it might. You never know. I mean, you know, look at things like Juno and stuff, where they just come out of Blair Witch or any of those that are pretty low key and then just explode, right?
Right. Do you have any convention appearances coming up?
I don't as of yet, but I was in the midst of changing some representation for the horror cons. So, new representation seems very optimistic. They have a bunch of Friday people. So, hopefully, fingers crossed, I'll be making some appearances coming up here, 2018.
Awesome. I hope you get invited to a California one, because I want to meet you so bad.
Oh, that'd be nice. But what part of California are you in?
Right now, I'm in Redding, California, but, like, I go to Los Angeles or back to the Bay Area where I'm from for conventions and stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. I'll keep that in mind.
Yeah. I met your mom at Monsterpalooza earlier this year, and she was a very sweet lady. She loved the fact that I was a fan of you.
Yeah. She's in Chicago this weekend, and I did Chicago last year. It's a great show. So she and all the Nightmare people are there this weekend.
That is, yeah, last weekend.
Yep.
Yeah, yep. I saw that. I was like, I was like, oh my god, that's awesome. I wish I could be there. But
it's a really fun convention, and they did they had a bunch of the Scream cast members last year and did an outdoor evening showing of Scream, which was really cool.
Oh yeah, it's
really cool. They introduced, like, they had the cast members like introducing it and stuff, so it was really fun.
Oh, that's cool. That's it, Nate. Thank you so much for taking the time today to talk.
Certainly.
Can I add you as a friend on Facebook?
Yeah, for sure.
Awesome.
Sure. I'll look for you.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you so much, and you have yourself a great day. It was great talking to you.
Yeah, good talking to you too, Tommy.
Okay. Have a great day.
Okay, thank you. Yep, you too.
Bye-bye.
Well, there you have it. Tiffany Helm. Ain't she a sweetheart? Thank you so much, Tiffany. I had a great time talking to you today. And thank you for being my 20th guest. 2-0. Well, if you like this video, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. And please follow me on Facebook and Twitter. Well, that's all the time we have this week on Splat from the Past. Until next time, this is Tommy Throwback Kovac saying, there's no shame in living in the past because the present sucks. Later, dudes.